The Commerce Department releasing a new report on the long-term impact of NAFTA as round three of reform negotiations is about to get underway. Join us now first on CNBC to talk about the results, the negotiations, China, and much more. Commerce Secretary Wilbur Ross. Mr. Secretary, great to see you. It's been a while.
Good to see you, Joe.
Be on all the time before you became such a big deal. Actually, you were a big deal, but now it's hard to imagine you're even bigger. But we hope to see you a lot.
Great.
And we're going to be here, at 7. Can you stay till 9? We're going to talk.
Surely. I have nothing else to do.
You have nothing else to do. When the auto bailout happened a few years ago, one of the things that people talked about was how important auto parts were to the whole equation. And if we had lost that, it would have been a major issue. That was one of the benefits. Looking at your op-ed and reading this stuff, I didn't realize how much auto parts matters in NAFTA, and that's really because it was written at a time when there were different parts. It doesn't cover any of the important parts.
Exactly.
We have. That's the lion's share of our deficit in NAFTA. Trade deficit is from auto parts.
In fact, it's autos and auto parts are more than 100% of the trade deficit. And the point you were making about auto parts being especially important, 70% of all the automotive jobs are in the parts companies, 30% are in the OEs themselves. So parts are really critical.
And we thought that we were sold the notion that when we take imports from Canada and Mexico, that all of the parts in those imports were coming from the United States, when in fact they're not. They're from non-NAFTA countries.
Yeah, that to me is the scariest part. The sharp growth is in parts coming in from outside NAFTA, from China, from Southeast Asia, from all those places. And when you think about it, the fundamental purpose of a trade agreement is to help the countries inside, not to make an easier market for countries outside.
So in auto parts and autos, it's the trade deficit with Canada and Mexico is $84.6 billion.
That's correct.
Everything else offsets that deficit by under $15 billion. It's not even close.
Right. The more than 100% of the reason for the trade deficit is auto and auto parts. Without that, there would actually be a surplus between U.S. and its two NAFTA partners. So it's a very, very important part of it. But the most shocking part, Joe, is the one you mentioned, which is that more and more of the content isn't even from within NAFTA.
And back when it was written, what year was that? I mean, the way that the what constitutes an auto part now is it been almost 100% turnover from what was an auto part when
this
was written?
Yeah, it's a huge turnover. The transmission systems are pretty much the same. Wheels are pretty much the same. Bodies are pretty much the same.
But everything else.
But you have now much more electronic content, for example, than you had back when NAFTA was
done. These might be pretty good jobs. In other words, if we were doing a lot of this stuff here with the guts of the autos and it was being made here, they'd be high-paying jobs.
Yes, they are. They're good jobs.
So how do you rewrite NAFTA now, and who's going to agree to it? It doesn't seem like Canada and Mexico would be against this since it's non-NAFTA.
Well, they shouldn't be against substituting U.S.-made parts for ones coming in from outside NAFTA. So one of the things that Ambassador Lighthizer has indicated he's going to do is push for higher total NAFTA content and especially for higher U.S. content.
And I'm just wondering how quickly it sounds like an ocean liner trying to turn this thing around. How quickly would you see jobs actually coming back here if you...
Oh, well, it would have to happen pretty quickly to get the negotiations done, because in 2018, U.S. Trade Promotion Authority, the so-called fast track, runs out. And given the nature of Congress, we don't even know if that'll be renewed. Without fast track, it'll be very hard to get any trade deals through. Second, Canadian provincial elections are mid-year. Mexican presidential elections are mid-year next year. And we have our own midterm elections in the fall. So if you get much into 2018, the political calendar will overwhelm the trade calendar.
Can I ask you a different trade question? It revolves around what happened this morning overnight. What kind of sanctions, what can be done at this point when it comes to North Korea? And are you involved in these conversations?
Well, the conversations are involving everybody because it's what the biggest single issue, North Korea and Iran, after the hurricanes, of course. Right. And I'm very proud of the work the Commerce and the other departments did in the rehabilitation after Harvey and Irma. And our heart has to go out to the people in Puerto Rico. That place has been totally devastated.
Right. The Eamon was on, Eamon on earlier. I talked to him about whether it's actually possible for a central bank to, like the Chinese central bank, to say we're no longer going to support North Korean banks. Will it happen? Was it yesterday? The president himself looked like he was shocked that China was, or he just said that was an unexpected move, that China would.
No, but a very welcome move.
Right, but do you believe it, number one? Is there teeth in it? Can it really happen? And what would the effects be to North Korea?
Well, we think that a lot of the goods going into North Korea have been in support of the missile program and the nuclear program. So if we can cut off their ability to import those things, that would be very good. And we saw with the Iranian sanctions, once the U.S. really clamps down on the monetary system, it really halts world trade because people have to clear transactions somewhere. And so I think that move by the Chinese central bank was important, A, from a physical point of view, limiting the trade, because China is the main trading partner with North Korea anyway. But even more importantly, it sent a very powerful message to North Korea that China is not being as supportive of them as it had been.
Right. What's our relationship like with China right now when it comes to trade?
Well, I'm going to know a little bit better over the weekend because I'm going to Beijing on Saturday. So when I come back, I'll be able to give you a more informed view.
Is tax reform the number one priority of the agenda? And of the administration, I asked you that because Kayla Tausche is getting indications from the administration, our reporter in D.C., that perhaps there could be a softening when it comes to some of these stances on trade, whether it be steel or NAFTA, in order to score points and get tax across the finish line.
Well, tax is extremely important because that's the biggest single, incremental factor in getting our growth rate over 3%. And that extra percentage point of growth is huge. It's $10 trillion over 10 years. It's $3 trillion of more federal revenue. So it's a linchpin. And it, coupled with the regulatory reforms that we've already been putting in, are what's really driving business. I think they're very much what's driving the stock market as well.
Right. It's a different type of trade.
Sorry, you didn't answer the question, though. Are we willing to have a softer stance on trade in order to win some of the support of some of the Democrats and some Republicans within the party? Are you willing to back down on some of the things that we really were saying that we would do, like backing out of NAFTA entirely or taking a strong stance on China? The investigation to steel dumping appears to be on hold right now.
Well, what we don't want to do is things that will unnecessarily irritate the Senate, because we need the votes there, and as was proven with health care, it's a very fragile margin. Yeah. So it's a question of timing more than it is direction. The president is certainly not going to suddenly be happy with trade deficits. He's not going to be happy with exporting jobs. But the real priority is to get the tax bill through, a tax bill that materially lowers the corporate tax rate so we can bring back businesses here, and to take care of the repatriation so we can get those funds that have been trapped offshore.
Well, if you talk to Heritage or you talk to American Enterprises, did they talk about tax cuts should be across the board? That's where, the philosophy is that money is better spent, better left in the private sector where it can be used to take risk to grow the overall pie. So we've now heard from the president that the top rate, and I don't know what he means by that, but let's say it's 5%, no tax cuts for the top 5%. If 60% of the federal income tax is paid by the top 5%, and suddenly that is no longer a pool that you're going to be able to cut taxes on, you're limiting your tax cuts to 40% of federal income tax. It just seems like it ties your hands just for ideological purity to be able to really appease the Democrats, because they're out in front saying it's going to be another tax cut for the rich. But it looked like the president actually kind of caved on that because of criticism that it was going to be a tax cut for the rich. If you, let's say you don't cut taxes on the top 10%, you're at 70% of federal income tax.
Well, first of all, let's see what really comes out. Remember, the administration makes a proposal, then it gets dealt with in the House, then it gets dealt with in the Senate, probably will end up in reconciliation.
But across the board, tax cuts are going to mean that some of the more successful, now we call them rich, so other people call them producers or the job creator or whatever. There's, right. You know, now it's almost a bad thing to be, you know, in the top 5%, or at least you're supposed to feel like it's a bad thing. But
well, I don't think that's it so much. I think the overwhelming priority is the corporate tax cut, both the
that's a
cut
small
in the
part
rate
of the
itself,
overall federal revenue, though, Wilbur. You know that.
Back.
What is that? How much of the federal revenue is generated
from
corporate?
9%? From the point of view of stimulating the economy,
no,
the important thing is really the more important is the corporate, and then a little bit of redistribution so that the people in the lower brackets get the real benefit. Those are the fundamental objectives.
So we're going to do, but I want to go back and just talk about one of the other, the sanctions on companies. It's not just weapons makers now, it's across the board.
Right.
Can't they get things from people that don't adhere to those sanctions? I mean, will it work? And then I worry about North Korea. How many people does he need to take care of to keep happy? His people have been suffering for decades.
Right.
So how many people, do sanctions work when he's only taking care of himself and his military
backing?
Well,
military spending is a huge part of the North Korean total budget.
So they could have a problem.
Anything you can do that smacks that down is good. And we especially think that a lot of the materials for the rockets and for the warheads are really coming from outside. Mm. So those are where it's particularly important, but you need to paint with a very broad brush.
All right, you're going to stick around, so we're going to have much, much more with Commerce Secretary Wilbur Ross in just a moment.
Wilbur, we were talking about steel imports and all that, but one of the things we haven't talked about is technology companies and IP,
right,
and how you've been thinking and working on some of those things, and especially how European regulators perhaps have been treating our U.S. companies. By the way, just as there's now a huge debate even in Washington about how our own regulators should
right.
be treating our own companies.
Right. Well, the internet companies and the other technology ones really seem to be an unfair target in the EU. It looks pretty obvious that they're becoming discriminatory because they're worried our companies are so much stronger than the ones in Europe itself.
You think it's political?
I do.
And if it is political, then what are you going to do about it?
Well, those are two very different big questions. I think what's happening with Uber is really not very justified in London. When it's for the UK people, obviously, to decide. But I think Uber is a wonderful invention. Every city that I've tried it in, it works very, very well. I think the London cabbies have probably been a little slow in adjusting to the new system.
The New York cabbies have been slow in adjusting, too. I don't know if you've seen the medallion prices have gone
down
as well.
Oh, yeah, have collapsed. And that's sad because that was a very good middle-class kind of activity here in Manhattan. What I can't understand is why the old-fashioned cab companies don't adopt the new communication system. When you think about it, Uber is fundamentally a communication system, but it's really good. Women going at night feel much safer in Uber because the Uber place is tracking them.
Right.
You get into a cab, who knows? You know,
will you be making a call later today to an official, a regulator in London to express your displeasure? How does this work?
Well, no, I'm not really involved in the Uber situation,
right.
And that's not at all to do with trade or fisheries, which is another big part of commerce, or
right.
the census, or the Weather Bureau. So we have our hands full doing the things we are doing.
Right, but when it comes to the way the EU has approached Google, or some of the IP issues in China, for example?
Well, IP issues in China are different because that very much is a trade issue. And they're not the only ones with whom we have intellectual property problems. U.S. probably has the biggest cache of intellectual property in the whole world, and everybody would like to free ride off it. You see in pharmaceuticals, many foreign countries forcing the prices of drugs down there, and that net effect is to push them up here, because the pharma companies still have to pay for the R&D, they still have to pay for the fact that most drugs don't get it through the testing, and they have to pay for the fact it took them 10 years to develop the drug. So a lot of these initiatives by these European and other countries are very much anti-US.
And I'm sorry, but did you say that there was nothing that you could do about that? I mean, what would the stance of the U.S. be in order to make sure that U.S. companies are treated fairly in Europe, particularly the technology companies?
Well, that's something one needs to negotiate. We obviously don't have a trade agreement with Europe. And in fact, there's a reason we don't have trade agreements with our big trading partners. Most of our deficits aren't from countries where we have free trade agreements. The big deficits, China is the largest country deficit, and automotive is the largest product deficit. That's part of the reason the automotive thing is so important in NAFTA. And within NAFTA, what's amazing about it, before NAFTA, U.S. had a $4 to $5 billion a year trade surplus with Mexico. You know what the cumulative deficit with Mexico has been since NAFTA? $1 trillion with a T. $1 trillion.
Let me ask you a question about jobs, bringing jobs back to America. We talk about what kind of industry can come back here and how that relates to trade. Masa-san was in New York this week for the UGMA event and was at gave a speech on Monday night where he talked about the singularity, which Joe talks about all the time. He says everything that he's investing in is ultimately about putting robots effectively in the place of human beings. I interviewed Tim Cook just a couple of weeks ago and asked him about whether manufacturing should come back to the United States. And he said, you know, you got to skate to where the puck is going, and I'm not sure that's where it is going in terms of physically manufacturing some of these electronic goods here.
Well, Foxconn is doing a very, very big project in Wisconsin. It's going to be 10,000 people over a period of time. Samsung just opened up a big household appliance factory in Tennessee. LG is opening up in, I think it's South Carolina. People are starting to come back, and I think with the regulatory reform and now assuming we get the tax thing through, that tax has been a huge deterrent.
Ask something about, I don't know about that thing. Let me just ask you real quickly. Caleb reporting that administration officials are seeking a softer trade stance so that they don't make any Republicans mad, because you're going to need their votes for tax reform. Like, you got to curry favor with these Republicans in Congress. So have you been told to go easy on trade so that you don't lose any Republican votes on tax reform?
No.
That's preposterous.
But is that something you would do on your own volition? You just expounded how important tax would be to the overall economy and that it is the number one goal of the Trump administration.
And you did mention that some of the Republicans that
timing.
You meet.
Yeah, the question is one of timing.
Have they seen their poll numbers versus Trump's poll numbers?
I'm sorry?
Have they seen their poll numbers versus Trump's numbers, like McConnell or Ryan at this point? They're in the teens.
In the key states, President Trump's numbers are fine.
That's what I'm talking about. His are 85 among Republicans. Right. Yeah, you're misunderstanding what I'm saying. I can't believe that you need to curry favor with Republicans to do tax reform. I can't believe you need to appease them so that they don't. What are they going to vote against tax reform? Republicans?
Oh, I think any Republican who votes against tax reform better hope
re-election already. Half of them.
I think, in fact, the failure to deliver to the president on the health care puts more pressure.
That's what I would think.
Republicans to do the tax bill.
Yeah, this has got no teeth.
But do you feel the pressure as well? I mean, do you feel the pressure that if you can do something, if you can back away from parts of your agenda at Commerce in order to get the greater agenda of tax done, that's something that should be considered?
It's not so much a question of backing away. It's a question of timing. The president takes very seriously his campaign promises, mm-hmm. among which was bring jobs back, in cutting the trade deficit. I don't believe there's anything, especially if you listen to his UN speech, he made it quite clear that those are important objectives. This is not a president who forgets his campaign promises. This is a president who delivers.
When can we expect something on steel? Because that's another, Kayla mentioned that you delayed it in July because of the legislative calendar. What does that mean? What are you waiting for with steel? It sounds like maybe you're waiting for this with steel.
Well, there are plenty of other trade issues besides steel. You have NAFTA underway right now.
That was a campaign promise too, wasn't it?
Sure. And the question is one of timing. It's not a question of direction.
Timing is everything. I've heard that. Wilbur, thank you. You got one more thing to say?
No, what I was going to say is Congress is very much a process-oriented organization.
Yeah. We've seen the process. That's why they're at like 6% approval, right?
Well, that seems to be the case right now.
Commerce Secretary Wilbur Ross, thank you for joining us this morning.
Thank you.
Always great to see you in person, especially.
Good to
see
you.
Thanks, Wilbur.
Hey there, thanks for checking out CNBC on YouTube. Be sure to subscribe to stay up to date on all of the day's biggest stories. You can also click on any of the videos around me to watch the latest from CNBC. Thanks for watching.